Welcome friends to this afternoon session of our program for celebrating the Bhandara of great master Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji. In the morning session, I mentioned to you how the word, sound, shabd, nad has been used. Kalma, Bange Asmani, music of the spheres, so many ways, it's all reference to something audible. And the audible part is our own conscious self. That is why sometimes they call it the audible life stream. That what we call life becomes audible at the physical level. And we can hear it. It's a good way to discover ourselves. That is why the yoga means union with our higher self or with the truth or with God, whatever our goal is, whatever we define our goal as the truth, ultimate truth, yoga is union with that. The union can be achieved by putting attention on the sound. The Indian words for putting attention on the sound is Surt Shabd Yoga. Surt means attention, Shabd means sound, Yoga means union with the truth. So Surt Shabd Yoga is one form of yoga. There are so many forms of yoga. Yoga become a very popular word. It's become a global word now. In every country they are using the word yoga. In every language I see the word yoga come up. But they have reduced yoga sometimes to merely bodily posture. Why? They say some of the founders of the writings of yoga, they quote Patanjali and they quote some others who have written books way back and described yoga. They said in that description, they have actually prescribed several different positions of the body and they give it different names. You can be like a peacock, you can be like an animal, you can be like a snake, you can be like a dead body, you can be like so many things. 84 positions have been mentioned there. So people think if we can do 84 bodily positions, we have reached the truth. How can physical exercises give truth like this? Truth is inside and we are doing physical exercise outside. Is that yoga? Not at all. We have reduced yoga to the most elementary part of it, which said, keep your body fit and then you'll be able to concentrate your attention, do real yoga better inside. To keep the body fit, you can do many exercises. But if you are meditating, especially in a closed place, like in the old days, a cave, a small cave dug up to do meditation. If you are sitting in a cave and have to keep your body, all the muscles in good shape, you can just change your position without having to do jogging and all that. That's the whole purpose. It is defined like that. We don't read that part. We think the exercises, bodily positions are yoga. It's not yoga. Of course, the mind over matter says, the suggestion, power of suggestion is strong. People say, I do yoga, I get peace of mind. I said, I repeat the name of my friend, I get peace of mind. I sometimes look at the sky, I get peace of mind. Of course you get peace of mind so many ways. It's a good thing to have peace of mind, especially in an age. There is so much turbulence here, so many distractions here. Therefore, peace of mind is not a bad objective to get by any means. If yoga gives you peace of mind, especially one asana, one position of yoga gives more peace of mind. It's called the Shavasana. Shavasana means pretend to be a dead body. That's the best. Isn't it wonderful that the best way to get peace of mind is to pretend to be dead? And I'll tell you really, that is very true. If you want to pretend to be dead, why do you pretend to be dead only by lying straight on the ground and giving up all muscular tension, say, I am dead, I am in Shavasana, I am getting a lot of peace of mind. Why don't you really pretend to be dead? Raman Maharishi, one of the great saints of India, got his enlightenment by pretending to be dead. And it did not happen by intention. It was an accident for him. He was very sick, had deep, very high fever, and he had one attendant with him. The attendant went away for some errand, and Raman thought he is going to die. He said, why am I afraid of dying? What is making me feel that I will end my life and I'll be, why should I be afraid? So he pretended to be dead. He pretended to be dead, he even held up his breath. And he said, if I am dead like this, I am not moving at all, then who is speaking in me? That's the beginning of his enlightenment, to pretend to be dead. I tell you, if you truly want to pretend to be dead, you can get enlightened just by that. But not lying shavasana and say, I'm pretending to be dead. Pretend to be dead where you have the same experience that people have when they physically die. I have seen many people physically die. At my age, my own friends and colleagues have gone. I have gone to hospices to see them dying. I have seen to hospitals and seen them dying. They have invited me to come and see before they go away. And I have seen them dying. When they die physically, they first die in their feet and hands. They are still talking to me. They don't know where their feet and hands have gone. They tell the nurse, please, will you move my feet to the left side? It's already on the left side. They become unaware of their feet. Then they become unaware of their legs and their arms. Then they become unaware of the bottom of the torso. Feel like floating. They're not floating, they lost the sensation of the bottom. Then when they reach the heart, they're dying slowly, the torso upwards, they can't speak. The eyes are moving, they're trying to communicate, the words don't come out. When the eyes stop moving, the brain is dead, the head is dead, they're dead. It's a process. Life is not withdrawn just like that. Sometimes this process can be quick, sometimes slow. But the process of dying is very simple, to withdraw life from the body upwards to the head. And when you leave the head, you're dead. Can we pretend like that? Yes, we can. To pretend this kind of death, we don't use any other method except to withdraw our attention to the head. When we withdraw attention to the head, we are withdrawing attention first from outside things and then from the body. And you will notice that the withdrawal of attention from the body starts from the feet and the hands. You don't know where they have gone, where you are sitting. Then you don't know where your legs and arms have gone. Then you don't know where your body has gone. Then you don't know where you have gone. And you are alive. The imaginative self, which is performing this exercise, trying to put attention on itself inside, is alive. Body is not in our awareness anymore. That is called dying while living, and it's a great way to go into enlightenment. It has been mentioned in many religions that if you can die before dying, it's mentioned in these Arabic scriptures, it's mentioned in the gospel, and Paul says, I die daily. It's been mentioned several times in Guru Granth Sahib of the Sikh scripture. It's been mentioned in the Vedas very much. It's mentioned in so many religious scriptures. And therefore, dying while living is a good way. Shavasana is not enough. So if you want to practice dying while living, you are really performing Surta Shabda Yoga, putting your attention on the sound of your own self that withdraws your attention from the body and makes you reveal to yourself who you are other than the body. Level one, withdraw your attention from the inner world. Level two, you go to third level, you can't withdraw anymore. And here comes the secret I promised to tell you. The secret of going beyond your effort. Because there is no way anybody can make an effort except with the mind. The ego, which is the face of the mind, it comes with thought. If you cannot think and put an I into your thoughts, there is no ego. Everything we do in this world, using our thoughts, is being presented to the world, presented to yourself, presented in experience through an I, ego. I am going to do meditation. I am going to find the truth. I know how to do it. Now, somebody told me surrender. I am going to surrender. They say it is effortless. I am going to try effortless now. One friend of mine actually wrote a letter to me. He said, I have discovered the true spiritual path does not come by effort, because effort confines you to the mind. Therefore, the true spiritual practice is effortless. And the last line was, I am now going to try very hard the effortless way. So you can imagine the contradictions. So simple we can make in our mind. I does not go away. Ego does not go away. Then there are teachers who say, ego is your problem. Kill your ego. Well, there's many ways to kill the ego, and I have seen people practicing. So supposing a person's name is Charlie. He normally says, I want a glass of water. He will say, Charlie wants a glass of water. Ego has gone. People do that. They think replacing the word I with another word takes the ego away. Ego is not a word. Ego is the assertion of our individuated mind that we are separate. It's a separation that makes us ego, egoistic. It's the feeling, I am separate from everything. I am separate from others. I am separate from things. Therefore, I am alone by myself dealing with other things, other people. Therefore, I can do this, I can do that. It's to individualize your mind to one I. And we think that's the face of the self. This is the face of the mind, not the face of the self. The self hides behind it. Self has no face. Self is what creates the mind. Self is what creates everything. Self is the word. Self is that power. Therefore, the I-ness that comes here cannot take us beyond the mental level, which is causal level, which is stage three, physical, sensory or astral, mental or causal. The word causal has been picked up for the mental state because we know that the mind causes all experiences to happen which we are having here. There is not a single experience we are having here in the heavens, in higher states of consciousness, that is not created by the mind. Therefore, mind is the end of these experiences. None of the spiritual experiences that people relate to go beyond the mind. Otherwise, they can't relate those experiences if it is beyond the mind. Therefore, the mind relates experiences made with the I, with its effort. This cannot take you beyond the mind at all. But something can take you beyond the mind. And that's the secret part. That which is available to you right here, now, which is beyond the mind, which you are experiencing now, that is what takes you beyond the mind. It's called love. Love is not a mental experience. No amount of thinking can create experience of love. When you fall in love with anybody, it's instantaneous. No thought is involved when you experience love for anybody. Therefore, love is an experience beyond space and time, yet taking place while we are here in space and time. Of course, love is a great experience. And people have described love as being the origin of experience. So many scriptures have said, love is God. God is love. The Creator is love. They give such an importance to love. It's the ultimate power. And we are experiencing it here every day. Sometimes not every day. But love comes again and again. We shut it down. We shut it down with our own minds by destroying it with our thoughts. Thinking does not encourage mind, love. Thinking creates doubt about love. Thinking says, are you sure about it? Do you really feel? Does he also feel? Does she also feel what I'm feeling? These are questions by the mind. And these are the questions that ultimately destroy the original experience of love. When love gets mixed up with ego, then it's not love at all. Then another word is used for it. It's called attachment. We are attached to people, attached to things, and we call it love. I love you. I love you very much. And if the answer is, but I don't love you, okay, then I also hate you. The very first statement, I love you very much, you are emphasizing I more than you to start with. The ego, you, the lover, is more important than the beloved. There is an experience of two. It's an attachment, not love. When you really fall in love, you have no time to think of I. Somebody asked me, can you tell me some secret how to put the ego behind, in the backbencher? Because in every activity, ego is front. I said, love is the only experience I know. You fall in love, at that time you don't think of why, you think of the beloved. You sometimes say, the beloved creates the love, not the lover. Something pulls you, then you feel love. No pull, you can't pull yourself, put yourself forth and say, I love you. That is all attachment. Very big difference between love and attachment. So therefore, when we say experience of love is God, spiritual, beyond the mind, we are talking of a love that is not sullied and contaminated by mind, by thoughts. When do we experience that? Experience all the time and destroy it. But if the love is sustained, it begins to reawaken itself in spite of the fight of the mind. A sustained love that never changes is unconditional, without any doubts about it. That is the kind of love we experience from a perfect living master. And there's a reason for that. A perfect living master is an ordinary human being, but his awareness at all times is above the mind. Not sometimes. A person, human being, who has had great experiences, remembers some of them, and comes and shares with us, is not a perfect living master. That's not the definition. Excuse me. A perfect living master is aware of all states of consciousness, including the state beyond the mind, at all times, 24/7. That's the big difference between us and a perfect living master. We are not aware of anything except what we are having in front of us. We are so limited in our awareness. We can only have one level of reality, and that's the only reality for us. Sitting here in the physical bodies, physical reality is the only reality for us. We're not experiencing any other reality. We go down into this dream world. We forget this reality. We become unaware of this reality. And the dream reality becomes real for us. We can't hold both together. If we are also aware of the wakeful state and also dream, it's called the daydreaming. It never becomes real. To create reality of a dream, you have to leave the awareness of the wakeful state. To create reality of a higher wakefulness, you have to leave the awareness of this state. If you come back to this reality, you have to leave the reality of that state. At one time, we can only have one experience of reality. When you are in that reality, you are convinced that's the only real thing. But when you go to the other reality, the first one looks like a dream. Maybe it's real, maybe it's not. That is why we are living in a state of awareness where we are confined to one level of reality. There are more than one level of reality. You can wake up again and again. Sometimes people who withdraw attention and go to the astral plane by dying while living, by forgetting this body, they say we have gone to a new reality because a new world opens up with different laws of nature. The same laws of nature don't apply to any reality. They're all different. When we go into a dream state, and I'm taking the example of dream state because we all can remember some dreams. Not all. Every night we all dream several times, proven through sleep institutes. But we remember very few. Some people say we never remember our dreams, but they still dream. Dreaming takes place continuously several times every night. Now, when we remember the dream, we know it's not real. But the sense perceptions that give us the experience of the dream are the same sense perceptions that give us the experience of the wakeful state. Reality is created in many strange ways. One way is what I'm explaining. If you shut off all other realities, keep only one, it's the only reality, then we call it real. How do we check reality? I want to check, is this glass of water real or not? It is real, I can touch it. I can see it. I tasted very good taste. Good water. It's real. Otherwise, how could I touch it? How could I see it? I am verifying the reality of a sense perception of seeing by touching it, tasting it, using other sense perceptions. Do you know, if you were to go to sleep and have a dream, supposing I'm talking to you in a dream, and I see the glass there, and I'm saying the same thing, is it real or not? And I can see it, I can touch it, I can taste it, same thing. And I will say in the dream, it is real. When does it become unreal? Only when we wake up. The reality we create at different levels remains real, no matter what, no matter how talks we hear or talk about it, our reality, reality remains one level. Therefore, the wakeful reality in which we are sitting now is just one form of reality, and we are verifying it first by blocking any other reality, and secondly, by using the sense perceptions of the same level. Not some other higher level, same level of sense perceptions we are using to determine what is real. We have no other means to discover reality here. If we had other means, we would use them. These are the only two means. Block your awareness from all other forms of realities, if they exist. Create a doubt, they may or may not exist. This is real, because my sense perceptions confirm this is reality. I don't know, I don't remember any other reality. When we go to the dream, same thing. When we go to higher awareness, same thing. Where does this then end? When we are in astral self, that looks very real. But the rules are very different. When we go to dream state, rules of nature are different. In a dream, we can go from one location to another in 1 second and looks normal. We're having a dream that we are sitting here. Within a second, we are moving to somewhere else. Looks normal. Nobody's ever questioned. How did we do that? In a wakeful state, we can't do it. In a dream, we can fall from a building and not get hurt. Here, we always get hurt. The rules, the laws of nature, the laws of natural law, which of the, each reality is different. What happens in the astral plane? In the astral plane, we try to communicate with somebody and we try to use words and looks very funny. I'm talking to a person who does not know English in the astral plane, can speak only German, Deutsch, and I am saying something in English, the person immediately answers in German and I understand it. How can that be? We can't do it here. Sometimes we can. Only when we use telepathic communication. Telepathy is not normal in this reality. It is picked up from there, but we don't realize where we pick it up from. In telepathic communication, the language is not what is conveyed. It's the meaning of the language that's conveyed, and same meaning is translated into the other language. At the astral plane, you don't even have to talk. You think something, other person can understand it. A different rule altogether. Another very big change, here time flows. Our experience of time is, it never stops. Time is continuously flowing. Or maybe we are flowing through time. Something is happening, it doesn't stop. In the astral plane, you can stop it when you like. When we were little children, we used to play a game called freeze. We used to run around, then somebody would shout, freeze! Everybody had to stand exactly where they are. It was a game. In the astral plane, it's a normal activity. There are so many differences. If you go to the still higher plane, the mental plane, by withdrawing your attention from the astral imaginative self, in the mental plane, the rules are totally different. Time can be seen as a static thing loaded with events. That's the beginning experience in the causal plane. You can go forward or backward in time with ease. You can see future and past of yourself, anybody else. It's an amazing experience, not possible in the other realities. So the laws of nature, laws of possibilities, are totally different in all these levels. So in the higher part of the causal plane, you can see how time is created, how time and space are created at one go, the whole time, infinite time is created, and how all the events are loaded upon it without time. And they become part of time when you come down to the astral and physical plane and we move on time and have those experiences. You get answers to all these things in the causal plane. That is why we have only one reality at one time. A perfect living master knows all the realities at all time. He knows all are unreal, just creations, and all look real. That's a very big difference. When can we have that experience of a perfect living master? We can have the same experience by going to totality of consciousness, our true home, where all the creation of all levels exists simultaneously. There you will find that nothing was existing outside. The whole thing was created in our true home where we belong. The whole experimentation of consciousness, creating things to be conscious of, experiences to be conscious of, is taking place in our true home, and that's where we have to go. Therefore, the reality, a relative reality, ends there, and we discover what is reality. The self is the reality. The conscious self, the source of all experiences, is the reality. The source, not the experience. The source never changes, experience changes. The source is called the self, the ultimate self. The source is called God. The source is called Allah. The source is called Ishwar Parmeshwar. The source is called by all names given to the Almighty Creator. that source can be discovered. This method of discovering the truth, I learned entirely from great master Baba Sawan Singh Ji, and anybody can follow it. It is very simple method. We have made it very difficult because of our attachments and desires. When we have an experience of reality, we get really attached. We say this is a real experience, a real people, real things, real objects. I love my car, I love my family, I love my friends, I love so and so. I am attached to everything and I don't want to leave anything. Therefore, over time that is spread out, these attachments bring us over and over again to the same experiences. Attachments is the source of reincarnation. No attachment, you don't have to come back. You can go to any level you like. Attachment to any level brings you back to that level. And therefore, we have the attachments created which keep us here. Otherwise, we can withdraw attention. When we try to withdraw attention, something does not let us do that. Our own mind and the attachments it has created. It may surprise you to know the soul has no attachment. The soul has no desire to stay on in any experience except the totality. The soul is a seeker of the truth. Mind wants attachments. Mind wants experiences. The soul provides life. Soul provides life to the mind and makes it alive. Soul provides life to the sense perceptions and makes the astral being alive. Soul provides life to the physical body, makes it alive. Soul provides life to the dream body, makes dreams alive. Soul is life. Soul is just giving life to machinery, to equipment that is used to generate experiences. Why do we need experiences? Because our self is consciousness. Consciousness means it has to be conscious of something. The very innate nature of consciousness is it's conscious of something, aware of something. Otherwise, the word consciousness wouldn't arise. Therefore, our very nature being consciousness, we are automatically creating through these different methods, mainly mind, even without the mind. What can we create without the mind? What is the, now if we go back to the top, one total consciousness is the reality and we call it the real self. We call it God, we call it the creator. It is the creative power for everything. What does it create? It has its own innate nature. It has love and some other things too. It has instant knowledge coming immediately, which we here call intuition. Intuition is not thought. Intuition is a gut feeling that comes instantaneously like love. Appreciation of beauty. Feeling of being in a state of bliss. There are several experiences built into consciousness itself. They don't need the mind to have that experience. We don't need the mind for that. Therefore, they are innate, built into our own original state. When we have the experience of a gut feeling in it, it's coming from the soul, from the source. When we have a feeling of love, it's coming from there. When we appreciate beauty instantly, I look at these flowers, beautiful. Now supposing you say, is it really beautiful? Is it red because of this, because of that? I lose the beauty. There are some things that are happening with us without time. They are intuitive, love, beauty, appreciation of beauty. These are coming directly from the soul. All other things like thoughts, analysis, understandings, they come from the mind. Mind works only in time and space. Intuition and soul works without time. That's a big distinction. And we have both kind of experiences right here. And at the astral plane and the causal plane. At the causal plane, mental experiences finish. And beyond that, spiritual experiences remain. Love still remains. Therefore, the secret of going beyond the mind is not effort, but being pulled by love. Whose love do you need to pull yourself up? If you want to pull your own self up to your own self, you need the love of your own self. Not somebody else's love pulls you away. You need the love of your own self to pull you up. How do you experience the love of your own self sitting here in this reality where the mind has taken control over our soul and everything is being done on the advice of the thinking mind? You can't do it. Therefore, when the soul decided to have an experience of this reality, did it not make any arrangement how the soul can pull itself up through love when needed? Was there no intelligence in that consciousness to understand you could get trapped in a creation that you created and you think that's the reality and keep on moving in that reality forever by attachments? No, it was super intelligent. Our consciousness, our soul was super intelligent. It made a great arrangement. It made an arrangement that when I am tired of the experience I'm generating, I should have a means to get back, and I'll provide those means from within. And the first step was, I will make sure that what is generated outside is generated from within. Then, in what is generated from within, I'll put my own self in the form of another being, because we are separating. I'll make it a separate soul. Some people have asked me, if in totality we were so happy, what was the need of separation? Before the mind. And I explained to them. In a true home, again, I have to give physical examples. In a true home, there is one totality called love. Not lover. Not beloved. Within that one totality, which is one love, we create the many. Within that, lovers and beloveds are born. Without going anywhere. A glass of water in my hand. One glass of water. No, I'm looking at it, million drops of water. Nothing has changed. Only my awareness has changed. By my awareness, I've divided it to millions. One totality, one God, within that, create the many souls. So love, which was nature of the Creator, becomes an experience of the Creator in the form of souls. It's a very big, great experiment done to make something that is in nature into an experience. At the very highest level, souls were created within the same, not outside. They never left. This is one example I give all the time, that when I was young, I was told about Sant Mat, the path of the masters. The path of the masters is, and experienced people were telling me this, who had been on the path of the masters for a long time. The path of the masters means we are drops of an ocean of reality and truth. Our true home is the ocean. We are little drops. Somehow we left the ocean and we drifted away, far away. And now we are wishing to go back to the ocean. We are struggling hard through our karma, through our life, through our struggles, through our meditation. We are struggling very hard for the ocean, drop of the ocean to go back and go ultimately merge in the ocean. This was described to me as a spiritual path. Even at a young age, I had a great doubt about this path. I said, if I am a drop, I'm a pretty good drop. Sun shines on me, I make rainbow colors on myself. I have a great time meeting other drops. I enjoy. As a drop, I can eat food. I can do many things. I can enjoy life fully. What are they telling me? Struggle hard, work very hard, and go and get merged in the ocean, lose everything I have now. What does the ocean gain? One more drop, it won't even care. This is the more lose-lose situation I have ever heard of. And this is supposed to be the Santmat spiritual path. I was totally disappointed, left spiritual path. I said, this is not for me. But I was wrong. That is not the truth. We are drops of ocean, but in the ocean. We are the ocean. The ocean which has itself decided to create the many within itself by separating units of consciousness which we call souls or drops. We have never left the ocean. Santmat, the spiritual path, is not to travel anywhere and go, it's to realize that you are the ocean. The drop becomes a larger drop. How many drops are of water are in this glass? I can make any number by awareness. It's the awareness that works to separate them. When the awareness expands, I can make it one drop, the whole glass of water. Same thing is there. The spiritual path, Santmat, is not of journeying somewhere. It's of realization. It's of awakening to a higher truth. Awakening to your reality. You are the total. For the sake of experience, you become small and become a drop. No going anywhere. That made sense. That means we realize who we are. Then spiritual path makes sense. We realize we are the total. And we are everybody. Some people following religion also hear these words. We are all one. Then they look at each other. We are all one. You don't look like this. We are one with all these, not that one. I don't like that one. What kind of oneness is this? Using the mind to understand oneness? The mind can never understand oneness. The mind can understand manyness. The mind can understand division, not cohesion. The mind can never make it one. Every day when you use the mind, you divide more, not less. When I hear about the teachings of the founders of religion, who say, find the truth within yourself. Kingdom of God is inside you. The truth can be found as his third eye center inside your head. When they all talk of going in, I am very impressed that religions are the same as spirituality. They are saying the same thing. But when I go to church, they say, only this God which we have monopolized is the real one. When you call God is not true. Only we who believing in one Savior, in one God, by our definition, is the truth. That is not what the founder of the religion said. The founder of Christianity said something else. Not only that. I meet a good Christian friend. I said, there's a church, let's go in. No. That's Methodist, I am Baptist. Do you have a different Christ or the same Christ? Do you have a different God or the same God? No, we have the God and Christ, they don't. What has religion done? Religion is nothing more than a mental exercise to divide. And so much violence has taken place in the name of religion. I got baptized just to examine the Catholic religion. I got converted to Islam just to understand if Allah is real. And Allahu Akbar, we say, is real. I tried so many things in my early age, college-going age, school and college-going age, to see where are we going wrong about it. How are we monopolizing the creator of the whole universe and putting into a little box of our own, and we call it religion. There should be something common. And I found every religion emphasizing the physical ceremonies to be done outside and not putting any emphasis on practices of meditation to go within yourself. So we moved away from spirituality in most of the religions. Religion could not give me any answer. I said, maybe I haven't studied enough. I got a fellowship from Harvard University in the United States. Very prestigious university. I was lucky to get that fellowship. They paid for my tuition, paid for my fare, paid for my food and stay. I was supposed to study economics, economic development, government, and so on, depending upon what I was doing in India. But I took up at this university a course in comparative religion. So I could study 16 major religions of the world to see what is common. Do they all tell us the way to meditate and go within or no? What do the religions say as they are being practiced today? I was surprised. Not all of them talked about love and devotion. Not all of them talked about meditation. But they did talk of one thing, all of them. Our religion is the only true path, all others are false. It's the only common thing I found. Division. So spirituality, which was the basic foundation of all religion, has been left behind. And rituals and ceremonies which are different, little bit different. In Islam, they are Shia and Sunnis. They both say Allahu Akbar and kill each other every year. How can you kill each other in the name of the same God? Why? Some external difference. One says when Prophet Muhammad died, the Khalifas were supposed to take over. The other say no, his son-in-law Ali was supposed to take over and they murdered Ali. So therefore, those who follow Ali are Shia, those who follow the Khalifas, Sunnis, they, to assert their truth about what happened historically, have to kill each other every year. It's amazing. I've seen those killings. In India, I've seen Shias and Sunnis killing each other on day of celebration. Is that we have come to religion? If you see the Christian crusades, how many were killed at that time? In religion, somebody estimated that religions have caused more violent deaths than any other form of death, of unnatural death. So what have we turned religion into? Where has love and devotion gone? Where is the secret of going beyond the mind gone? Now, when I said we made a very good arrangement with our superintelligence, the arrangement made was, since the whole experience is projected from within, in the experience, when we are ready to go back home, when we are ready to end this experience, we will generate an experience of another human being like ourselves. And we will pretend he has more awareness than we have. And we will lower our awareness to one reality and make that person have total reality. And this arrangement is made before we left our true home. So what happens? When we come to this physical experience, ready to go back home, that arrangement we made comes into play. We are seeking the truth. We are fed up of the experience. We have had enough of it. If we don't say that, then the arrangement doesn't come into play. Supposing we say, I am having a good time, I love this life, he'll come again and again. But the moment you say, I have had enough, this is not my place, I don't feel, I belong here. When those feelings come, I don't belong here, I don't fit in here, and I want to seek the truth. Where am I? Who am I? Where do I belong? When those kind of seekings come in our head, a perfect living master appears in our life. Just appears. Arrangement made by us. But why should he appear outside? Why doesn't he appear inside? Because inside the mind looks and searches for things. Search does not give you something that is beyond the known. Seeking does. See, you seek inside, nothing happens, so something happens outside. There are so many teachers, gurus, religion, religious priests. They are all telling you, come to our outside place, come to church, come to temple, come to mosque, do this, do that. All outside rituals. Perfect Living Master says, go within your own self. Obviously, how is he concerned? What is his interest in telling us, go within your own self? We say, why should we go within ourselves? You have come in outside, we feel your love for us. We want to spend time with you. We want to spend time with you. There is some pull coming from you, and we know that your love is very pure, it's unconditional, we have seen it. Why are you telling us to go in the opposite direction within our own self? What is his answer? He says, what you are seeing is not me. I am inside you. Go in and see. When we follow that simple tip, we go inside and see, real master was always inside us, not outside. We did not know how to look inside, and he appeared outside just to tell us how to look inside. When we look inside, what does he say? He says, let's fly more further inside. He doesn't say, let's go outside and find some more. Further inside. When we go further inside to the next plane, he's still there. He says he was always there because we made the arrangement. Then what happens? We fall so much immensely in love with that being, starting from the person outside, now inside. We can't explain that love that we have for that person. And then he says, now you can't do anything, I'll do it. What will you do? He says, I'll pull you with the very love. I'll fly to the true home, and you will have to be tagged on to me just by your love. So with the love, he pulls us through to our true home. That is the secret. When we reach true home, what do we find? He was our own self. Our own self pulled us. But we have no idea of our own self. No idea at all right now. We think the body is ourselves. Maybe some astral form of ourselves. So maybe there's a soul traveling around here or there. None of this is ourself. Ourself is the totality of consciousness. And there we discover that what appeared as a perfect living master in a human form was no other than our own self discovered at the highest level. It's an amazing experience. We call it a journey. We call it a spiritual journey simply because at each of the three levels of creation, we can actually travel in space and time. Therefore, we can fly higher. We can find new skies there. Of course, the skies are also different. So the skies being different, they're given different names to the regions. The descriptions of events there are different. Experiences are different. Therefore, we call it a journey because going within, we can start flying in the inner sky. That helps because inner sky is very vast. So is this one outside. But there's a difference, little difference. The outside sky at night becomes dark. Other side might be sunlight now on the planet. But we see darkness and we see light. This is a world of duality, darkness and light. It's a world of pain and pleasure, world of pairs of opposites. Everything here is in pairs of opposites. When we go to the first stage, sky is still there, but neither dark nor light. It's somewhat between the two, remain the same. We can turn it little less lighted, see stars and moons and things like this, heavenly things. Or you make it bright light and see the sun shining. But it does not go into darkness. When we pull ourselves in the causal plane, there is no darkness at all. It looks like the sky has suddenly turned into a golden sky, an orange colored sky. It's an experience of an external experience happening at different levels because of time and space. And that time and space at the mental causal stage creates an orange-colored sky. Beyond that, there is no space and time, and no description is available. But for the sake of creating the story, consistent with the rest of the story, Master has said, that's an even whiter sky, more bright than the causal plane. Therefore, imagine the sun that is shining. It is stretched over the whole sky, that will be the nature of the sky beyond the mind. Just a way of saying something. Just a way of describing, because we can't understand any other way. And in totality, you put trillions of suns together, there's more light there than you can see. Just a way of describing how different it is from here. Totality is everything. Some people say, when I go to my total true home, what about people I've left behind? There will be no people. They're all there. You'll be surprised. Nothing will be left behind. People say, if I go to totality, will I have other people in other places left behind? That's our nature of journey. Then they don't understand totality at all. Totality is total. There's nothing outside of it. This universe is there. The dream universe is there. Higher universes are there. Everything is there. Therefore, when a human being appears with an awareness of all levels in totality, he is at all levels of experiences at the same time. Very different from us. We are confined to one level. He is aware of totality. Therefore, when he says we are all one, he's talking of another level. Not this level. When we try to imagine we are one with the mind, it doesn't work. But when he says, he's telling the truth, because we are all part of the same source. So that is why this is the real spiritual path, to discover the true self, to discover who we really are. That's what we are. We are totality of consciousness. We are all really one. The whole creation is one. Not only we are one, everything, this flower, this glass, this table, this physical, the universes, they're all part of one. That's what totality is, that's what a reality is, that's what we call our true home. Sach Khand, that home of truth, lies there. And imagine, what takes us there? Our own seeking. Nobody else. Nobody else can take us. Our own seeking within our own self. When we seek within our own self, Master appears outside. We seek inside, Master appears outside. When we are ready, he comes forward and says, let's go, we are ready. When a Master says, let's go, we are ready to go home, we say, we are waiting for this. That's what we are seeking, to go to our true home. And he says, go within yourself. That's the route from the physical plane. The Master is present when we see him outside in a physical form. He's present all the time when we see him in the inside form. He is completely with us at all other forms. Ultimately, he and the Master and our soul are the same. That's the spiritual path. Imagine, I am sharing something with you which I have experienced from the presence of this gentleman with a white beard, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji. So when I invite you, come and join with me in the celebration of Bhandara, I am celebrating the appearance of this man in my life. Somebody said to me, supposing nobody comes to Bhandara, will you still have Bhandara? I said, of course. I'll never be alone. Two of us will celebrate, Great Master and me. Because if you practice meditation, after being accepted by a perfect living master, like Great Master, and do reasonable meditation, not all the way down, just a little bit, enough to think of him all the time inside, he will manifest inside, because when he accepts us, he places himself inside us. And we can see him inside And he is available to us 24/7 after that. So you never leave, he never leaves. Since we don't do enough meditation, we want to find the truth as taught by religion, go to places and find out, go and listen to more discourses, listen to more lectures, read more books, maybe you'll find it. These things I've never given anybody, except more haughtiness, egoistic feeling, I read more than the other. I am following my practices more than the others. It's just a growth of more powerful ego. Therefore, the real thing that happens is only when you begin to go inside and discover the master inside. Master we see in a physical body. I saw the master, he was old. And he told me, he said, if you want to see the inner master, do it early in your meditation. Don't postpone, because I was very young. So he gave me a little hint, do it quickly. Once you see him inside, then don't bother, the rest of the journey is done by the master. Your job ends when you go inside and meet the master. Then say, master, I've come, now you take me home. And he takes you home. This tip he gave to me, but still, I was busy with so many other things. In fact, after initiation, I was still searching other forms of yoga. I was still searching other things. On 2nd of April, 1948, physically he died, left his body. I said, have I lost my master? I used to go and see him. I used to visit the Dera in Bias on the river bank and see him. Now I can't even see him. And he appeared right in front, outside. He said, I'm inside you all the time. Why don't you make friends with me inside? If you make friends with me inside and are with me inside, I'll be with you inside and outside all the time. He has kept his word. Very big thing. That's perfect living masters. When they accept somebody, which they call initiation. Initiation. They say he's granted initiation. It's just a word. Because initiation has also been misused in so many ways. The real thing is they become a friend of ours to go together on this beautiful journey to discovery of our own self. When they do that, they manifest themselves inside us. Once you go inside and reveal them and hold on to that experience inside, they appear inside and outside all the time. Therefore, when I come to an occasion like this Bhandara, we are celebrating Bhandara. Bhandar means abundance, a lot. Normally, they say the Bhandar of food. There's a lot of food. Bhandara, celebration, eat what you like. Many people have taken that so seriously that their attention is on the food rather than on the meditation. They come to Bhandara, good food is served there. I heard this in the United States when I first came, and people said, we are celebrating Bhandara. I said, can I also join you? You're celebrating your masters, great masters, or some masters, Bhandara. Can I join you? They said, yes, food is excellent. Last Bhandara, they made lovely this thing, this. They counted all the vegetables they made. And they also told me about the sweets, desserts, pudding they made. That was definition of Bhandara. It's not abundance of food, it's abundance of grace that he gives on that day. Just because we thought he died, he did not die. He lived far more than we could see him when he was alive physically. That's the beauty of it. That when a perfect living master who has appeared in our life in a physical body dies, and he has initiated us, he remains with us and is visible to us both inside and outside for the rest of our life and for the rest of our experience to totality, to our Satchikan. That's the beauty of it. That is why we celebrate Bhandara, not the death of a person. Some people are asking me, Are you celebrating the death of a person? No, we are celebrating the real life of the person, which we didn't know existed. We don't even know our own real life. That we never die. The body dies. The inner body dies. The mind dies. We never die. Soul never dies. It's immortal. And therefore, death doesn't occur to us, the self. It only occurs to the covers that we are wearing upon the self. And this discovery becomes very strong when we celebrate. So what do I see? Another secret. The secret is that I see the great master blessing those who are present here when we celebrate his bhandara. And I see him blessing everybody who's present. It's a very big experience for me to see my master, who has blessed me all my life, blessing so many of my friends. Why? Because they are seekers of the same thing I was seeking. We are co-travelers. We are traveling to the same destination, our true home. And when I see the master giving that kind of blessing, it blesses me more than I can ever imagine. That is why I give great importance to this day. And we have been celebrating, I've been celebrating the 2nd of April every year as the day of Bhandara, where I see the maximum grace being distributed. And I tell my friends, good time, fill up your bags. This comes rarely. Some things in this physical world, even in spiritual elements, come rarely. We are told of a story of a king who was a follower of a mystic. The mystic was a cobbler, shoemaker, and shoe repairer. He would repair the shoes. And his little hut where he repaired the shoes was just outside the palace of the king. The king became his disciple because he said, everybody told him, he's a perfect living master. He can help you. The king was a seeker of the truth. The cobbler worked hard. The king said, master, why are you doing this work of mending shoes of people? Come and stay in my palace. You are a master. You should be more comfortable than this. You don't need to do all this work that you're doing. And the cobbler master said, no, I have come with my destiny. I have brought a life pattern which I lived through. You got your pattern. This is connected with our own past lives. I am supposed to be a cobbler. And I enjoy being a cobbler because it's fitting in with my own past lives. You are a king. You're fitting in with your past life. Our lives in the physical plane are based upon a karmic pattern of past lives. Therefore, don't bother me. I'm very happy to be a cobbler and to mend shoes. One day, the king said, the master sits just outside and he said, 3 o'clock, wake up and do meditation. And we can't meditate. We like to sleep at that time. But if I woke up and went to him, if I go meet the master physically at 3 o'clock in the morning, middle of the night, maybe he'll give me something special. So he just dressed in some disguise to, like an ordinary person, and escaped from the palace early morning and went to the cobbler master. The cobbler master got up. King, what brings you here middle of the night? He said, I have not come as king. I've come as a beggar. King, please bless me. Please bless me. The master said, you believe in holy water? Here, he took out some water in his hand from the very cup in which he had put some leather to soak it up. It was a little dirty with the leather. He took a little handful of water, said, drink it. And the king said, I came for blessing. He's giving me dirty water. So he pretended he was going to drink it. did like this, let the water flow to the sleeve of his shirt. He said, thank you, and ran. What a mistake I made, the king thought. I thought he was going to give me some blessing. All this master could give was dirty water. When he went back to the palace and took his shirt, which was still wet, he saw there was a little stain of the leathers. He said, this stain will be seen by other people and I should get it washed quickly. So he called his a servant in whom he had confidence, and he said, there is a washerman on our palace compounds. Take this shirt right now. Tell him to clean it right now in the night and dry it and bring it to me before the morning. The servant took the shirt to the washerman, and the washerman woke up. What can I do now in the middle of the night? He said, the king has sent this shirt. Don't tell anyone, but you have to remove the stain and wash it and make it ready before the morning. The washerman said, okay. So he tried to wash. His young daughter woke up. 9 or 8 years old daughter. She woke up. What are you doing, Dad? Oh, king wants this to be, and I have the stain to remove. He said, come, I'll help you. She took it, and instead of washing with soap, she began to chew upon it. She began to chew upon the stain, and then tried to wash, so the stain was getting removed. But she was getting enlightened. She began to talk of higher levels of coexistence. The washerman said, what's happened to you? There is something in this shirt that I'm feeling. And she cleaned the shirt and sent it back. In the morning, she's giving a discourse to the father. I'm telling you, father, this is not real. Go and find. So what has happened? Word spread around. People began to come. A little girl has become a saint. Little girl is enlightened. And the king heard about it. He said, a little girl has become a saint. I didn't get anything from that guy who gave me dirty water. Maybe the girl can give something. So he went to the girl. And a lot of crowd was assembled there, because they all began to worship that girl who was talking of higher levels of consciousness, higher levels of experiences. So the king stood there and said, I want something from you. She stood up. No, no, no. You are the king. He said, I have not come as the king. I have come as the beggar. She said, I have not stood up because you are a king. I have stood up because you have given me whatever I have. He said, I gave you nothing. He says, you gave me the sleeve of that shirt that has given me everything. The whole thing was in the shirt. He was surprised. He said that dirty water was so powerful that it could make a young girl enlightened in no time. He said, thank you very much for telling me the secret. And he ran to the cobbler master. And said, master, give me some more dirty water. He said, sorry, king. These are very rare moments that come. This is not the normal rule. Normal way is through meditation and discovery of your own self. But once in a while, these perfect living masters, they can feel how strong your urge was that night at 3 o'clock. How you came as a king, forgot you were a king, and came as a beggar. And I said, I have to give something good. But you didn't digest it. You couldn't take it. Now you have to meditate for some time. Find and discover the normal way. So why I'm bringing this to your notice? Because some things happen at certain times. And 2nd April of every year, since my whole life after initiation, has been that special day when something special happens, and the grace that flows is unlike any that I see elsewhere. That is why for me it's a very special day, becomes a very special day for all my friends who come on that day. So I congratulate all of you for being here. You may not see what you are getting, Meditate and you will find what you are getting. Go inside and check it out. All the teaching that I share, great master teaching, I am sharing because it works. I am not sharing because he just told me share this, what I am saying, a philosophy. Only that part I am sharing which works. Therefore, it's something that you will be able to get and experience it. You will see what happens. It's only a few days left for 2nd of April. And 2nd of April, I'll tell you more about this great master, the greatest master that I ever met. Thank you very much for spending time with me today. And there are some people who are not going to stay on for the Bhandara for 2nd April for some reasons. And some have to go immediately after this talk. If they want to have a few minutes with me for personal time, I'll be very happy to see them today or tomorrow. But those who are going to stay on, the time fixed for personal meetings, some personal times where you can ask questions, check your own progress, or whatever you want to share with me, can be done after we finish on the 2nd of April. We use one day, 3rd of April, for distribution of prasad blessed by great master. I'll have his blessings, which I will watch and see the blessings, then distribute it to you. And then on 4th and 5th of April, we'll have personal meetings for those who can stay on till then. I hope I'll be able to accommodate most of you. Of course, preference will be given to those who have never met me before. And the second line of preference will be those who have come from very far off distances. And third, all the rest. I try to accommodate all the rest also. So thank you very much for your patience in listening to me. And I'll see you
tomorrow.
When do I see them?
Tomorrow.
What time then?
11.
Tomorrow at 11?
Yes.
Tomorrow at 11 o'clock we meet again. Very happy.